Well, hi guys. Right, so hopefully, by the time you see this, I'll have organized in my base a little something for you guys, and I hope it all worked out okay. Anyway, how this is me well before that stage, trying to prepare it, trying to think about how I'm building this system. So what we're going to go through today is going to probably be quite a large episode. It's going to be a special because I'm really pleased that 21 of you have decided to subscribe to my channel, and hopefully that's going to increase. And it'd be nice to have a digital display, I thought, on my Minecraft worlds for keeping track of that. Now here is what I'm going to be doing. So you'll have already seen this running, hopefully, but what we're going to go through today is the gubbings and how it all works, and I'm going to be learning as well. So here we can see some of this bundled cable, and that bundled cable just goes around to each of these and it's attached to one of each of these items, and it's reorganized it for me very handily. Okay, also remember a redstone wire against one of these lamps, one of the redstone lamps, will carry the current across two lamps, so the one that's connected to plus the next one. So each of these, the bundled cable won't affect these lamps. I'm just doing that for space efficiency really around here. So how do we get these to light up? Well, let's have a look. I'm going to put down a white wire here, and there is the white one lit up. Off again, and yellow or orange, and that's on again. Okay, so how do we control these? Well, I'm planning to use a bit of computer power for that. I thought that's fitting with the series. Now, let's go through a few items I've got laid out here. This is the CPU, the central processing unit. Here's the floppy drive. Now you'll need the fourth boot disk in there to get anything to run. And then we have a digital display, and this acts as the console for the computer. At the back of here we have some ribbon. That's that ribbon cable that allows us to connect components together. These three items don't need to be connected together because they're sat next to the CPU. But coming through here, we have what's called an I/O expander. Now, if I pull out my screwdriver, left shift, right click on that, we can see that it's got an ID4 on this bus. That means we can output items, or we can output commands from here through this I/O expander. I've got another one set up here, and that's set to ID5, so a different ID. And the reasons for that, this can output 16 channels through these ribbons, but what I was wanting to do is be able to have a repeatable program controlling each of these. And if I get so look into the future, perhaps I might have more than 100 subscribers so we can expand it. I say it laughingly because I never expected to have 21 of yous interested in what I've got to say. Anyway, right, so how do we switch it on these items? Now there's some things you need to know about the wires. Just going to lay them out now. So it's all in binary. You can see here this matches the colours I've got around here: white, orange, magenta, light blue, yellow, light green, pink. Now each of these are controlled. We can output a number from here, and that'll be converted into a signal through this cable here. So let's try 1 IOX for output. Ta-da! Okay, if we try 2 IOX and slashes for output, or the band character, the exclamation mark. Okay, so that's switched on this one, switched off that one. Okay. What about if we go for 3 IOX bang? Bang is a computing term, sorry. Exclamation mark. Okay, so that's switched on 2 of them. How's that working? Well, that's because in binary, we've got a series of zeros and ones. And let's look at it from this side. Okay, that's going to be handy. Okay, so white up there, when it was set to IOX 0, nothing was on. Nothing on, okay. When we set it to 1, we got a signal through the white. Okay. When we set it to 2, signal through the white went off, and we only got a signal through the orange. And when we set it to 3, we didn't get the magenta on, we got orange and white. Okay. Now this is what binary is all about. Okay, so the white is equal to 1, orange is equal to 2, and this always doubles up for 8, 16, 32, and 64. Okay, equating to the numbers around here. IOX, bang, that should switch us on the magenta channel, right in the middle. Okay, so how do we make numbers out of this? Well, you've already seen one number, output in 3. Gave us 2 lit up. If we go around the back here, see those 2 lit up. So what's the best way to convert the digital or the binary number to what's a decimal number? If you have a look up here, so say if we want to make a 3, and remember this is all in reverse, we'll need the green on, we'll need the pink on, we'll need the magenta on, and orange and yellow, or orange and white. Now, I'm saying it's in reverse because that would equate to that being on, that being on, that being on, and those 2 on. So that's the 3, yeah? So it's in reverse on this side. Okay, so how do we determine what the number is that we need to output to get those to switch on? Well, that is basically, we need this one on, so that is a 1. We need this one on, that is a 1. If this one on, that's a 1. Off, 0, off, 0, on, 1, on, 1. So binary is an on-off signal. And if we write that down, if you write it from... Yeah, okay. So we need a 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. 5, 6, 7. So I've got 7 numbers there. Now, you'd normally have this in reverse order when you're thinking about binary. So over here, if we read that back in reverse order, so we'd have a 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. And that would give us that over there. Now, let me just write that down. Oops, I want... I'm so used to actually making the items I need that I can't even remember the names of the items. I'm looking for sign. Okay. Okay, so let's say our number 3 equals, and I'm going to write it out in reverse, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Now this number 3 is our output of 3, but that's not what this digital number actually equals. This digital number actually equals 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 32 plus 64. Okay, what is that number? That number is 103. Okay, how can we figure that out easily? If we come over to one of these IO expanders and shift click on it, or shift right click, we can also plug it in here, which is kind of handy. This is the reverse order of how binary is normally written out. So if we go back to the numbering system we used before, so we had a 1110011. Okay, 1110011. What is that number? 103. Okay, and that is how you can easily work this out. Okay, what do we have it set to? I had it set to 4, so that'd be 3 and 1. No. Just switch it all off. Just trying to get it back to the right IO expander number. Okay, so let's plug that number in. So 3 was 103 in binary, or in decimals. 10x, bang. Or IOX. Exclamation mark. 3, hooray! So that's basically how I'm going to work out all the numbers and how to switch it on. And the reason why I'm using the computer craft that comes with Red Power, it's more fitting for the series. Plus, just to do this would be hugely, well, would be a big, what am I thinking of? And if you're just to build it in Redstone, and you can build these in Redstone, you will have a massive, massive machine. And just being able to use a computer to control it has brought it right the way down in size. Okay guys, before we start programming, there's something else to know about this system. So it's a stack-based operating system, which means that when you place variables when you place numbers into the system, it fills up a stack. And it always places the next item on the top of the stack, and always takes an item when you want to use an item from the stack from the top. That means it's last in, first out. The last item you place in the stack is the first item you take out of it. Let's say that we're working with, say the blue or the white blocks are equal to 1. Okay, so let's have a look in here. If I type in page, it's going to clear that away. Words is the command to display all the words that the system currently has. If we type in dot, it'll tell us it's an empty stack. It means we've not placed anything on there so far. If we place 111 there and press return, okay, on the stack now we'll have 111. We can see that by typing dot s, and that'll print out whatever's on the stack. If you just type in a dot, it's going to take the first item off the stack. Remember, that'll be the last number that we entered. So if I now look at what's on the stack, there's only 2 items left. If I type in dot dot, it's going to print out the one, dot now, it's an empty stack. Okay, so let's put the 111 back on the stack. Now, the way this stack operators work, it's a reverse Polish method. If you look at reverse Polish, it'll tell you a little bit more than I will, but effectively it means that your values go in first and then the operators. If I type in a plus here, let's have a look at what's on the stack. Okay, so what's it done there? It's got a 1 and a 2 left on the stack. Basically what it's done is take the plus operator needs 2 items from the stack, so I'll take these two, the two ones, add them together and place the result back on the stack. So that's why we have a 1, 2 on the stack. If we do another plus operator, it gives a 3. So it's taken the 2, the 1, summed them together, and given us 3 left over. If I type in a dot, that will just print out the 3 and the dot s now, empty stack. So that's pretty much what you need to know. You can also do, so you could all put all this in one line. What's that going to give us? That'll give us the 3 we had before. So take these two items, add them together, take these two items, or that remainder of those two plus that dot and then 3. Various ways to write this line out. It's basically saying add the first two together, put the remainder on the stack, add that to a 1, then print it out. And it'll give us the same result. Basically, it's always you'll need values on the stack for whatever operator you're using, and then you can do extra things with the result of that. So that gets combined into a 2, and then that operator needs two items from the stack, that's the 1 and the 2, and that gives us a 3. Okay, so if I type in page just to clear that out. Something else we need to know, so if I change back out of creative, should have a screwdriver line around. So if we shift click or shift right click on there, we've got an idea of 4 on that bus. I want to make sure that this is going to use that bus address. So IOX ADDR space exclamation mark. We'll make sure that we're using that bus there. Now, again, if we type in 1 IOX bang, it's going to turn when the light's on up there, and 0 IOX exclamation mark. There's no space here, it's a difference. Everything's off again. You can also do place items on the stack. That's on the stack. That's on the stack. Type in IOX bang now. It's going to take the top item off the stack and print it out. So that was a 2. Next one is the 3. That's given us the numerical display of 1. And that's pretty much all you need to know. That what you're going to be writing, if you're writing programs into the system, is you're going to be operating on the stack. Okay, let's have a look at creating our first program. Now, what I want is something that's going to convert a value from 0 up to 9 into the digital display value. So what we'll do is, that's a colon convert that tells the program we want to write a new word called convert, and then it comes up with this compile thing. What we want to do is take whatever's on the stack and copy it, so we use the dupe command. That means we'll have the two items on the stack, the one that we enter, one that's there before we start the program, and then we've just duplicated that. So we want to use that value on the stack, and we're going to say add another 1 to the stack, use the equivalence operator, so take whatever's on the stack, compare it to the 1 that we've just put on the stack, so that's going to take the top two items. If they're equal, then what we want to do is write 3 to the IOX, and then we'll finish that if statement. Next up, we want to reduplicate whatever's on the stack, so now there'll still be just the two items on the stack, the thing that came in, and this. If 2 is on the stack, print out 109 to the IOX device and finish that off. And I'm just going to do this for all the numbers, and I'll be back with you in a moment. Okay, so here you can see all the numbers. So if you've lined up the wires as I have done, you will get, you can use these numbers to convert between, so the 1 is 3, 2 is 109, 3 is 103, 4 83, 5 118, 6 126, 7 35, 8 127, 9 119, 10 63. To finish off this program, we just enter a semicolon and hit return. Okay, so we do have something been printed out. Now this command here tells the system which IOX address to use. You need a space between the IOX ADDR command and the semicolon, unlike this IOX. Okay, and then we'll just make sure it's all switched off with 0IOX. And let's just check if there's anything on the stack currently. Okay, nothing on the stack. So if we add a 0 onto the stack, call our convert program, and brilliantly nothing happens. Let's see, 63IOX, bang. Okay, that's a 0. So it's the right value, I've just got the commands wrong. Let's see what is on the stack. There's still 0 on the stack, that's what we'd expect. You know what I've done? I've typed in if it's 10. I've got that wrong. This line here should be 0 equals if 63IOX. No way to edit this, it's a real pain. I'm going to have to type it all out in a minute, but let's go for a different number. Let's empty the stack. So the stack is empty. Let's put 9 on there. What do we have displayed at the moment? Okay, so at the moment there's 9 on the stack. We're just going to clear the display device. We still have 9 on the stack, so I'm going to type in convert, and that should display as a 9. Hooray! This is working. Guys, you've got no idea. I've had to learn quite a lot to get this to display just this number. Okay, so I've made a mistake with my program on this line. I'm going to have to redo it. Okay, we're back, and I have reprogrammed it so that 0 is now the correct display. Now, we're going to be working with two numbers, say 21, for example. And how are we going to split this across two displays? Have a look at our stack. Okay, I should have emptied it out properly. Stack is empty. So say if we've got 21 on the stack, there's a new command we're going to be using for this. It's called mod. Right, we have an empty stack. Okay, there's a new command. 21 is on the stack. What we want to do is use the modulo command 10. Okay, so that's going to be 21 mod 10, if you were to read it in English. Modulo basically divides a number and gives you the number that's been divided plus the remainder. So if I have a look at the stack now, I'm hoping there's going to be a 2 and a 1 on there. Only 2. What's it done with the remainder? Is it remainder 0? Doesn't get placed on there. That should be remainder 1 anyway. So what's going on? There's another command I saw earlier on. So let's empty the stack. Let's place 21 back on there. Let's do 10 slash mod. Let's see what's on the stack now. Okay, that's more like it. There's the two and there's the one. So the slash mod is the modulo that gives you what the number is divided by 10 plus the remainder. Which means we want to write out whatever's at the top of the stack to our tens digital display, that AOX address, and we want to write out whatever's at the bottom of the stack to our ones units. So let's try that. So let's create a new program. To do this all for us. So this will be call this display, we want to duplicate what's at the top of the stack, and that's going to be say the 21, that's now duplicated. Then we want to do our 10 mod, which is going to get us what was originally on the stack is still there, plus the tens unit and the 1 and the zeros units, what do you call them? Well, the unit, I guess, would be the right thing. It's been a while since I've been in the maths class. So what do we want to do with that? We want to stick the first thing through. Let's do 5 IOX ADDR bang. Write the first thing on the stack out. Then do 4 IOX ADDR, then write the second thing on the stack. Just hit return, it'll take a little while to compile that through. Okay, so that should be enough to get us these two displays up and running. Let's make sure this is set to 5. So that's 5, that's 4. So let's do, right, what do we have on the stack? So there's 2 and 1, let's delete all that. Nothing on the stack, let's put our 21 back on there, and let's do display. Ah, yes. That shouldn't have been an AOX. That should have been our convert function. Okay, let's try one more time. So it's going to be pretty much the same command, display digital. Let's duplicate it. Do our 10 mod again. Call the 5OX ADDR convert 4 IOX ADDR convert. Should take a little bit longer to compile, I'm sure. Okay. Right, now what do we have on the stack? We've still got the 21. So let's display digital. Convert is non-destructive. So maybe I should have made it destructive. Let's try once more. Display digital. Dip. Hmm. Right, display digital. Oops. Well, I've got a real problem with typing in digital. Okay, duplicate. 10 mod. 5 AOX ADDR convert. Dump the top item off the stack. 4 AOX ADDR convert. Dump. Actually, I could have used. There's another command, a normal word called dump. That would save me having to write it out to the screen. I could have just used dump here. Could have used. I'm pointing at the screen. Could have used dump here and dump here to get the top level items off. Okay, let's try. What's on the stack at the moment? Nothing. Okay, that's a bit of a surprise. Okay, stick 21 back on. Let's call our display digital. There we go. So that's how we're going to do two-digit displays. Now, what I'd also like to be able to do is have an input into it. Where are those pesky signs? I thought it'd be somewhere around the top. Ah, well, we can just use that one. Let's clear that out. Okay, so what we're going to be able to do is say add one smiley face. Remove one sad face. Remember, this is all about subscriber numbers, so yeah, obviously that'd be the right thing. And this would be better obviously if it was over here so we could see it working, but well, it's a general gist. This is just a proof of concept, and this is all going to be in a loop. So what we want to do is eventually call end, and this will be run at the end of a series. So let's put a double sad face in there. Okay, let's stick some buttons on here. Okay guys, so I've finished up the wiring on this. So here's my three buttons, and they're all connected to some redstone wire here using just some diamond strips, because it is you know, it's creative mode. It doesn't need to be diamond strips. Any strips would do to separate these three redstone wires down here. And then out of that, we've got 1, 2, and 4 as output. That's kind of come into this AOX ADDR here, or this AOX device. If I shift click on that, that's set to an ID of 3. Now that's the default AOX ADRA. That's fine. So what we want to do now is create a looping program that's going to monitor for button presses and just continually run. What we'll do is call this main loop. First thing I'd like to do is make sure we are displaying whatever is on the stack at the start. So we'll display digital, and then we're going to start a loop running with the begin command. Next up, we want to tell it to listen on the IOX ADDR 3, which is the one where the buttons are connected to, and the exclamation mark there. Okay, next up, we want to say One IOX fetch. So this is a different command now. Exclamation mark is send a value. At is fetch. Okay. We're going to test that whether the one is equal to the value that we fetch from the IOX. And if it is, we want to add one to our stack value. We want to display digital. Then we want to pause for a little while, and this is so that the button press doesn't trigger more than one addition. Okay, so 20 ticks is equivalent to about a second, so 100 ticks is 5 seconds. So we'll be able to repress the button every 5 seconds. Right, let's take that down to 2.5 seconds, 50 ticks. Okay, next up, let's take a little while to compile that. Okay. So next up, if we receive something on 2, we'd like to decrement by 1 whatever's on the stack, display that, pause the program, now, as I said, this is going to be a looping program, so we want a way to exit out of it. So we'll listen for the 4. If we receive that, we'll exit. The last thing I want to do is, if we have reached 0, so we're going to need to duplicate what's on the stack to do this test. So if 0 is what's on the stack, exit also. Next we'll tell it to go back to the begin with the again command, and then we'll compile it. Okay, so that should be pretty much it. Let's check what's on the stack. There's nothing on the stack. Let's put in 21 onto the stack and call our main loop program. See there, it's printed at the 2 and the 1, so that's working okay. Okay, let's increment by 1. That should change it to 22. 2.5 seconds later, we can take 1 away. I was playing around seeing if I could make a better looking display. I'm still going to have to work on this. But there's a 21. Let's go down to 20. 19. 18. Now if we have a look over here at display, we're still getting an output. What I might do is add a carriage return between each of these, so you can probably see a carriage return. So I'm going to put all the programs down in the description of the YouTube video. If you're looking to see what's going on, they're the ones that I'm going to be using in my base in the main world. Okay, so the main loop's still running. Let's end it. Let's check that works. Okay, main loops came out. Okay, let's just see what's on the stack now. It should be 18. Okay, let's get rid of that. Let's put in 1, then call the main loop. Okay, so modulo 10 does get a 0 in the tens column, so that's cool. And then what happens when we go down to 0? We've got 0 printed out, and this should have exited. And it's exited. Okay, that's great. Okay, last things. You don't want to lose this. It's been a lot of work. So let's take this blank floppy here. That's the 4th disk being exited. So let's just go into save. Oh, just want to see, make sure I get the right command. You can probably see save, right, there it is. Right, save, brackets. Now, you need the space here. Let's call this digital work, and that's going to put a name on the disk for us. And it's going to save all our words from the system out to that. Okay, there we are, it's saved. And if we right click on this now, we'll get digital work. Okay, so... Oh no! All the work is lost. Well, let's just make sure it all works still, so... Right, we're gonna just plug the fourth disk in there. Right, let's reset and then start. This should come up with mine OS, 600 bytes free. So if we type in words now, you can see it no longer has my words in there, which is what we'd expect from the fourth boot disk. Let's exit that out, put ours in now. Halt it, reset it, start it. So 241 bytes free. So that means all three of our programs has taken up just over 300 bytes. If you type in words now, it's got the main loop, the display digital and the convert in there. But it does mean we don't need to do anything about the expanding the memory of this CPU to get this display up and running. Okay, let's just check everything still works. So what's on the stack? Nothing. Let's put 21 on the stack, call the main loop. Output, and we'll decrement it, so that's down to 20. Okay, well that's perfect. So I am going to do a few things. I'm going to figure out how to best get a digital display up and running, and I'll probably do that off camera. Well, hi guys, welcome back. So, redone the wiring, redone the display. I think this looks a lot better from this side. We'll go and have a look at it from a distance in a second. Wiring's a lot neater, and also you don't need as much bundled cable, which I think is more expensive than these other ones to make, so it's going to be pretty handy. So you can see all that there. Let's move away. So I think that looks pretty good. Switch it to nighttime. It's pretty good. You can see it from quite far away, so still looks like a 20. Okay, so I think what I've decided to do is, this is going to be a separate video to me putting it all together in my base, simply because this is, I think we're up to about 45 minutes now, so let's call this the computer craft tutorial video, and me putting it together in my base for that special you saw will be out on the next video. So thank you for watching, guys. Hope you found it useful and informative, and I shall speak to you next time.